guess who we have waiting to come on, Richard? Yours and my friend.
Sheila
is such an all-star. So let's introduce Sheila. Sheila Murphy is a career and business development coach. She's the CEO of Focus Forward Consulting, and she's someone who lifts lawyers and leaders in legal organizations. And before Sheila started her own business, she was actually a senior VP and associate general counsel at MetLife for many years. So we're getting a lawyer's perspective now. And here we go. Welcome, Sheila. Hi.
Hi, it's so great to see you both. And I appreciate the fact that you left out how many years I was actually there.
I did that. Oh, it was just a few. No, this is your second event tonight, right? Weren't you on another event somewhere?
I was just speaking at another event, but there's no place I'd rather be than with the two of you. So I'm happy to be here.
Thank you so much. Thank you for joining us. We're thrilled to have you. And what we've been doing, we've been having different contributors in the book pop into the broadcast with us. And we have questions for you, of course, because my book is a Q&A book. So you ready for a couple questions?
Yeah, I am ready.
Awesome. So Richard, you get to queue up your question.
Well, thank you, Sheila. It's a pleasure to join you today. And I'm going to hold you to another one of our compliance coffees in New York sometime this summer.
Okay. I'm raring to go. I am ready to start meeting with people again.
Excellent. And I reread your contribution over the weekend, and something that was so foundational and inspirational was the part where you talked about what we don't say. So what would you say to a CEO or anyone in an organization's leadership that doesn't want to talk about ethics, that thinks that, well, that's part of a support function, the former Sheila's, that's what they need to be talking about?
It's a huge mistake. I mean, really, compliance starts at the tone of the top. And if people don't hear it from the CEOs, they will put in other notes as to what they think the CEO believes, especially if the CEO, as I think I mentioned it, the business person that I talk about in the book, was someone who talked about driving profits, returns on equity, all the financial things that put pressure on people to make those metrics. If you don't include a discussion on ethics, you are leading people to think that they are not important to the person at the top. And the other thing we have to remember is we're now going to this hybrid world. And in this hybrid world, people are going to be in and out of the office different days. They're going to be meeting in the room some days not. And you really want to make sure that those messages that ethics matters permeate the organization consistently. And there's no better way to do that than from the CEO. And you don't have to be in the room. It can be a video. It can be some messages you send out. There are so many ways that they can communicate that doesn't take away from other messages, but enhances what the company is about. And when you don't have that from the CEO, people will make mistakes. And those mistakes can be very costly to an organization, not just from a financial, but reputational place. So I really think that if CEOs and other top business leaders aren't making ethics and compliance part of what they discuss more frequently as we move forward into this new normal, then they're making a mistake.
Absolutely. That's a great point.
And I agree with that as former commercial Richard and current compliance Richard. Right on.
No, and also to be honest, you know, lining up compensation with compliance is important, especially when you have people where it may not be front of mind in their job. And for a while there, I know certain organizations, and I thought it was really smart, especially with their sales forces, which, you know, are very compensation driven, they started putting in a compliance component to their pay. And I thought that really kept everyone at least focused on the idea that this matters.
Yes, definitely. Sheila, there was something else that you wrote in your contribution. I'm actually going to quote it because I thought it was really interesting and I'm hoping that you can elaborate on it. You said, just because we, and I know you were speaking as lawyers, can make an argument doesn't mean we should. What do you mean by that?
A lot of times, you know, attorneys want to be right. We love being right. We love being clever. We love finding some little loophole. And the point was, especially when you're an in-house counsel and you're part of the company, just because something, there's an argument to be made to defend an action, or there's an argument to be made that you can do something or try to do something, if it is something that hits you as not ethically right on the mark, then you may have an obligation to sort of speak about that piece too, because especially when you're in-house, you are part of the company. And making people aware, yeah, we can make an argument, but you're going to lose in the court of public opinion. Or we can make an argument and we might win, but is that really who we are as an organization? And is that the message that we want to send? I think it's really critical that people not just think about being clever or winning, but also that you think about as an organization doing the right thing and having the courage to say it. As a lawyer, as a compliance person, as the lower level business person at the table, making, you know, just because you might be able to do something doesn't mean you should.
Right. No, that's a really good explanation. Thank you. And, you know, I just wondered, because to go from a company where you stated in your book about the CEO who didn't speak about ethics, and the company was very profit driven, and maybe
I didn't say it was my company, the CEO.
So a company.
I just want to make that clear.
Yes, definitely. So whatever company it was, if that's the culture, so you're talking about culture now, and it takes a long time for the culture to be rooted in an organization. Do you need more than just a few times that the CEO sends something out? Is this more change management and a process that you really have to go through to make this change happen?
You know, a lot of people do Gallup surveys of employees that measure engagement and how employees feel about things. And one of the things is about the ethics of organizations. And when that comes out low, organizations really need to take a hard look at what they're doing. And, you know, when you look at changing a culture, that can take up to 10 years. It is not a quick fix. And so it really is embedding a cultural change in a change management system. And that's where most initiatives fail, is people roll this out, the CEO sends out a few videos in this, but he does it. It's not a constant theme about what they're talking about. The message isn't cascaded down. People aren't rewarded for doing the right thing. I don't remember. I think it was Tylenol. When there was a guy who stopped the Tylenol for going out, and he was a lower level. They touted that person. Someone did the right thing and they got rewarded and they were brought in, you know, and praised. And so you have to make sure that you're sending the right messages, not just sending out notes, but you're really reinforcing that with your actions, that you are rewarding and touting people that do the right thing and not just the people who are bringing in the money at any cost. And so you have to have a system, you have to be tenacious about it, and you have to realize that it doesn't happen overnight. And I would say if you're doing polling and you realize you have an issue, that you probably need to do some frequent touch polls to see if it's going in the right direction, because you really are talking about a cultural change that makes a difference. And you may have to make tough decisions in your leadership if people aren't supporting this type of initiative. Because again, the cost to companies when you don't have an ethical organization is more dramatic than just the dollars.
Right. Richard, any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I wish you could align my image with Sheila's vertically, because we're so aligned on everything that she had to say. And I mean, there's just saying that do the right thing, just say no to bribery, that's not a policy. As Sheila said, that's a wall poster. Like, that doesn't operationalize anything. And when ethics and integrity and responsible business practices are coming out of the voice of leadership, out of the corporate narrative, not just out of the former Sheila narrative. It just sounds so louder to the workforce because it's sending the message that doing the right thing isn't a support function. It's how we do things around here. And there's some deep research about, and this is something that Sheila addressed, if we think of ethical and compliant business decisions as just policies, rules, and procedures, that can actually distort our decision-making instead of helping it, because we think, wow, if there's not a rule for this, it means it's a permissible interaction. And as Sheila referred to, especially in this environment, we have seen so many lawful but awful decisions that have had catastrophic consequences to good organizations and what we might think of as world-class brands. They have taken some serious hits to their reputation because of that, just policies, rules, and procedures. Here's the code. Here's what you need to know. You're good to go.
Right. And just to jump on what Richard was also saying is, I also remember when people, leaders that I know, took positions that were financially harmful to the company because they were the right thing, and people became aware of it. It was much more impactful than a wall poster. Having people make decisions based on what's the right thing to do and making sure that's touted, even though it might hurt earnings. So you're down a cent in earnings because of that decision. But those things do matter to analysts. So when companies stand up and say, we're going to do the right thing, and leaders do, it does impact people and how they look at things.
Yes, I definitely think it's moving past the wall posters and the handbooks and demonstrating your ethics and all the people you serve. And sometimes it's the people over profit in certain instances. So thank you, Sheila. Thank you very much for all of your insights. And we're going to pop you into the green room because we have...
Hi, guys.
Hi, we have Lee Sun coming on. We'll see you again soon, Sheila.
Thank you. See you soon. Bye-bye.